idea behind the album was to create an album that was not your generic house and techno album, I guess. I'm not saying I've invented the wheel with it, but it's kind of got a story or a concept behind it. The concept being to try and create an album that reflected the whole house and techno scene from its kind of inception to where we're at now. So in doing that, I had to take into consideration, well, where was its origins? So Detroit being always regarded as the home of techno, and Chicago the home of house, and then where it developed from that. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to work with kind of key figures from those particular eras and some of the pioneers from those times, and almost create a musical journey and but constantly reflecting on the scene's sound.
Not only was it important to work with the established artists and the pioneers from the scene, but it was also integral for the album's concept to work with up-and-coming producers and the kind of new talent that's about. And in doing that, it was important to work with the new breed of artists that have appeared in the label so far. So on the album itself, I worked with Tom Taylor, Mia Wallace, Express 2, Andy Slate, Eddie Folks, Ben Long, P. Ben, Marshall Jefferson and Robert Owens, Carol Cox and Steve Ward, Darren Emerson, Lenny D and Frankie Bones, Adamski, Detroit Grand Poobahs, Mash, Squire, Raymond, Lindsay and Kendall, My Evil Twin, Michael Gregg, Werner Niedermeyer.
I was very much a kind of rock indie type kid in Nirvana. And at the time when I was at school, there was a lot of, in Scotland, there was a lot of raves, or rave music was going on, a lot of rave bands, and it sounded cheesy to me. So I always associated, I think, electronic or dance music is kind of cheesy synthetic music. Prodigy released Firestarter. I always remember it on Top of the Pops, hearing it or seeing it. And I knew it was a Prodigy, and I knew I wasn't meant to like that kind of song, but the energy behind it was pretty intense, and it was similar to, you know, what maybe drew me to Smells Like Teen Spirit or something like that. I just had that kind of enthusiasm.
The late 80s rave scene obviously has had a, you know, the culturally and socially everything changed from then.
The orbital raves, I was more into the clubs than doing the raves. I went to the raves. I did go. I remember seeing Carl Cox giving out flyers and stuff. And we'd done a rave down in Raynham called Part One Warehouse in 1987 it was. Oakenfold DJ'd there. And it was fantastic. It was like, you know, early days. And a lot of the guys that used to sort of go to Ibiza, it was just bubbling. Not many people knew what was going on, but there's a lot of people doing mad dances and stuff going all night, going, wow, that's a bit mad.
After I got into the rave scene and listened to the tapes, I would go to the Resurrections in Edinburgh, travel down to Fantasias. From where I was from, up in the northeast of Scotland, the Resurrections was like a new world to us, you know what I mean? Coming down, and there was like 6,000 people going mad for it. Yeah, at that time, it was special to me in Scotland, definitely.
I was very fortunate to do the first raves ever in Scotland. And I don't mean Resurrection and those, there were parties before that. And it led me into you know, the Scottish scene, which I really, really loved. I really loved. I loved the people. I loved everything about it. It was awesome. You know, it was different than in London, but it, you know, the kids were up for it. They were really up for it. And as the hardcore music at that time was the beginning, it was 91 for me. Yeah, about 90, 91 was the time, I thought, you know. And wow, they really rocked. The Resurrection and that whole party really blew out the Scottish rave scene and Scottish hardcore, happy hardcore. So many things got to, you know, that came from that. And then all the European DJs from other countries coming into Scotland, more so for this hardcore music than in like lower parts of England or Ireland or anywhere else. So Scotland became a very, very, very important for hard electronic music of all kinds, happy hardcore, you know, industrial hardcore, speedcore, and you know, whatever kind of hard sounds that you want. The Scottish scene exploded too, and a lot of producers like Scott Brown, I mean, they just blew up, and you know, it can't be overlooked at all. I mean, Scotland had a really big part of the UK overall scene, and I'm happy to be part of all of it from England. I love it there, I really do.
I don't really know how it all works, but it's obviously, you know, it's still having repercussions now, and you know, the BBC news theme is like a techno track, and I think there was, you know, there's always been these people that, you know, play guitar or cello or flute or whatever and say, oh, it's not really music, you know, you're just pressing a button, and but it, you know, I prefer mechanical music, that spiritually, I get more out of things that are very robotic and syncopated than jingly jangly, splishy splashy kind of sweaty music.
Sometimes I think that the concept of the album is gone nowadays, and creating a story behind the album, I think it just adds maybe a little bit more weight and a little bit more value to it. And I felt no one had really done this. You know, people, don't get me wrong, people have worked with a variety of keynote figures, but I wanted to do this because it hadn't really, to my knowledge, it hadn't really been done before. And it's almost like a kind of encyclopedia to the sound.
I was absolutely blown away by it. I thought, you know, it's a really big task to start. Delighted to hear all the names that are involved in it. I mean, a lot of names that I've heard growing up, a few folk I've met, a few folk I'm, you know, that are absolute heroes, and it's great to be part of it. It really is. I'm privileged to be in with names like all the folk that are involved, and it's a great album. And I was saying that to Gareth when I actually heard the album altogether from start to finish. It's a brilliant listening album. You don't just, it's not like a lot of DJs make tracks and it's just DJ tracks just for playing out, but that from start to finish, playing it, you know, as you would listen to it back in the day, I think listening to a tape or listening to a CD, I think that's how it should be listened to. And it's got its dance tracks in there, of course, but it's a very good listening experience from start to finish.
You wanted something to, that things that are people that inspire them, or and who he admired. And I think it was a good concept. It's not a concept that I think, you know, it would be tackled by just anyone. I think Gareth's got the determination to see everything through, and it took a long time to get the album to where it is.
I haven't necessarily wanted to create an album that's emulated particular sounds, you know. For example, the Robert Owens and Marshall Jefferson track, it was there to, obviously, we're trying to create an early house type track, but it was very stripped down, so we used kind of modern day approaches and techniques.
We went to London to mix the album, and when I first heard the Adamski one, it was just a big wall of sound. I think there was just far too much on the track to just to get some space in the track to make it sound good. And I've just actually recently heard the final version of it, with the 3-4 beat kind of waltz thing that he's known for. It's completely different from when I left London to when I got the masters back.
My thing is that I can only be on your album if I can do 3-step. You know, I refuse to do anything else. I was back in the studio last year with Seal, and we started working on some tracks, 3-step tracks, and him and his musical director and the other people involved wanted me to work on this other track, which was in 4-4 time, and I just can't do it. I've made a kind of pact with myself and God or the devil or something, the universe, to only work in three-step timing, and then maybe I'm, you know, shooting myself in the foot. But anyway, I thought it was very, you know, for Gareth to say, yeah, cool, let's do something three-step. You know, anybody that's open to going off on this tangent, I respect, and I'm up for it. I have to always keep it interesting for me. I've been making music for several decades, and I'm currently into only making music in waltz time, in 3/4 time or 6/8 time, whatever it is. It's re-energized me musically, and I have that parameter of only working within this time signature, which anyway, I know that the waltz revolution in the mid 18th century in Vienna, in Austria, which then emanated across Europe and the world, was the original dance underground. And I love, you know, drawing the parallels between that and the acid house rave revolution that I was heavily involved in, and that whole thing inspires me.
I knew this was going to have legs because it was such a strong thing for me, you know, like in the early days, especially going out in the acid house days. That revolution was just so big, you know, it's like just swept the nation, you know, and it was like, how can you that's not a fad, you know, that's people want to go out and party with really good music and having a great time, you know. Everyone's has been doing that from the disco days, the Northern Soul days, but that one was a pretty sort of big smash, you know. It was a big like explosion.
Did you think then that you were breaking new ground? Because obviously what you're doing is...
Oh, of course I did. I'm American. I thought there would be a House Music Hall of Fame by now and I'd be the first inductee. that's what I was thinking about, you know. I mean, it didn't quite work out like that, but it did. I did pretty good. I mean, I'm still only doing music, you know, and it's been 28 years now since I quit my job at the post office. I really thought it was gonna have a really long shelf life, and the reason for that is I thought white people were gonna get in it and take it over, like, because all the most popular music has started out as dance music, you know, and it evolves from that. The problem with house music is it never evolved from the dance floor, right? So like, that's what's actually held it back, and because it's gotten so formatted, that's what stopped it in its tracks. Because rock expanded, it evolved, you know, into like where you aren't even dancing to it anymore, you know. And like, I mean, from Rock Around the Clock, it started out as dance music and everybody's like doing all this, and you know, and it was great, right? And it kind of left the dance floor for a little bit when you know, you had Frankie Avalon and those guys singing ballads and stuff, but then the Beatles brought it back to the dance floor, and then they evolved from the dance floor and it became more like, you know, like thinking music, and you know, then you got the hard guitars and all that stuff, and then but you also have folk rock, you know, and country rock, and all, you know, all this different evolution, and I thought that was gonna happen with house music, you know. I mean, it, even though it started out as dance, you know, because, well, that's why I wanted it to leave the dance floor, because I'd seen what happened with disco, and you know, disco just died, you know, because people revolted against it and stuff, like, you know, it, but I really thought it was gonna last a lot longer.
we all know this, things go round and round, you know, and it's every now and again you get something which is new, but it's, you know, and then like, for instance, the acid housing was very new, which was completely different. That's why it was so fucking cool, you know. It was like that sound, you know, that Pierre and all that sort of created from the 303 was just like pretty sort of out there. But then if you get it, you know, it was just such a groovy little squelchy mad sound, and it worked. But then it will go around again, then it'll disappear for a little while, then, you know, it just goes round and round, you know. So the Detroit sounds, and that are definitely coming back again, like old school Detroit sounds, you know, because these kids like don't remember those days. I'm just getting to sound like an old man here, maybe I am, but it's an older man. But you know, the thing is, these kids don't know the early days, but they're really digging it. You know, the Detroit thing, the techno thing as well, future music. It was about moving forward, you know, and it's definitely done that. And I think it'll carry on. Yeah, I don't think it's going to stop now. Dance music's like here.
A friend of mine introduced me to the art school and the techno nights that were going on there. And again, I didn't really know what techno was as such, other than it being a 4-4 dance beat. And initially I didn't really, was unsure about it, but then I kind of, I started to kind of pick up on that kind of sound. And that's really, you know, it was nights like Test and Radar that I was going to the art school, and then Soundhouse. And it was really from there that I started to properly get into that kind of music. At that time I was actually playing in bands, and then I quickly realised that, you know, the band split up and I wanted to kind of start producing music just on my own, without having to ironically work with other people. And then, but then ironically I do more collaborations in the electronic producer, I guess.
I think techno, the roots from techno really are, I suppose, Detroit. For me, that's where it came from, you know, which was quite, just more energetic, sort of, the energy from it, you know. I'd say Detroit, but then from that, they would say it came from people like Gary Newman and Kraftwerk, and so a very European thing. It was all about the electronic thing, which was taken over and then sort of gave to us from Detroit and that. And then of course then it went to Germany, and that's when things got tougher, you know. That's when it got a bit harder, and you know, and hard house and stuff like that, and you know, that Sven and stuff were pushing it on those. And then it started getting really like up to 140 BPM, you know, pounding sort of beats. But it was great, you know, the energy from that, you know, really got you going, you know. And I love all that, you know, so yeah.
Yeah, the Chicago and Detroit music of the late 80s influenced me very much. I mean, I was really into electronic music anyway. And I was into dancing in nightclubs and discotheques. That kind of started from two-tone when I was like 11 or something. And there was the big two-tone revolution, and ska and everything was very much about dancing moves. The Detroit and Chicago music kind of gave it a bit of a formula, and those records I used to listen to pirate radio in London, like LWR and stations like that, and those tracks used to just leap out the radio at me, and those early Chicago and Detroit sounds, and but they were, you know, in turn influenced by a lot of European music like Kraftwerk and Joy Division and the British group Imagination. I used to hang out with this guy Jimmy Polo from Chicago in 1988, and he used to tell me a lot of the things that they were into over there, and it was quite surprising, you know, some of it, and I just like the way it kind of cross-pollinates across the Atlantic and around the world. But yeah, I'd say the music that got me a record deal in 1989 was a fusion of Chicago house, Detroit techno, and European electropop, really.
Oh yeah, I think New York scene was very influential. Same as the Germans, the Dutch, and everybody else. Every other city, you know, we had our take on it. We definitely, the producers that came out of New York, were wide, very, you know, a lot of range of different kinds of styles and sounds. And, you know, back then it was, you know, just a few of us. If you're looking at like in the end of the 80s and the 90s, there were a lot of musicians doing this stuff, but, you know, what transcended everything was the DJing and, you know, how to, you know, how all that kind of, you know, meshed together with the music. So yeah, I think New York had a really big influence on house music and dance music in general. You know, you can cite different producers along the way, and, you know, but I still think, you know, electronic music is a global, you know, community, global phenomenon, not just a city or a place. Though every city along the way has its, you know, its push to accelerate the music or to make it grow. So I think, yeah, New York had a really good part of it, really, for sure.
Co-promoter with Gareth, we run the Bulletdodge events, as they are called. We've had Vince Watson kicked it off with a live set, and from there we've had another live set from C-Tech, Darren Emerson, D-Type Campubas, and Marshall Jefferson, just to name a few. The nights are really focused around the Bulletdodge label itself, i.e. why we have the label parties. So basically, whoever we have signed to the label are the only people that would play our parties.
The residency at the Limelight started sort of after we were doing our things in Staten Island, believe it or not. Some of the promoters there, I had a big trip and I took every one of them to England with me and showed them what electronic music was, what I was doing every weekend, and not what we were doing in Brooklyn or Staten Island or America for that reason, which I thought was pretty sad considering that the rest of the world was kicking it. In my own country, I was, yeah, wasn't really too happy about what was going on musically there. So the residency meant a lot to me. It was how I'm going to push all this music I'm getting worldwide. And, you know, I'm on this top DJ 100 and all this, and nobody gives a shit. And I'm thinking, you know, this residency is going to be everything. It's going to be all the music that I think. And, man, we brought so many acts into the limelight. The scene that was created from that, wow, was amazing. So many people got touched by that period of time. And I don't mean with the drugs and what you see on TV and all that crap. And that existed, and just like it exists everywhere else. But musically, it was a challenge too, because, you know, the crowd was still not 100% with electronic techno music. House music, yeah, you know, because it was coming from the disco, and, you know, I hate to say it, like, house music was an extension of music that, of kind of real music just made electronically. But techno music went against all that. Hardcore music or hard rave music, whatever you say, went against the traditional, here's my intro, here's my bridge, here's my hook, here's, I mean, we had all those things, but not, you know, saying it with songs or with these super, you know, live, you know, musicians and all that stuff. And a lot of the stuff could have been out of sync, out of key, out of whatever, but it you know, it was the venue and having that spot in the church where the parties were was wow. It meant a lot to me, and to give the people back what I was getting musically all over the world was a bit of an honor for me, a bit of a power trip too, because I figured, wow, man, I'm, you know, no, I cannot fail, because, you know, they're just gonna get music nonstop, and I don't have to worry about what this guy's playing at this club or this or that. And, you know, that residency brought electronic music into New York, and it brought it to the kids. Though it was ahead of its time, and the police and all the other things that happened afterwards kind of like destroyed the scene. But the Limelight residency was the beginning of it all for me in New York. Anyway, it was where it really was beyond the dirty rave scene, beyond all the parties that we were doing in the park, and, you know, worry about getting arrested for playing music, to be honest, which is crazy now that you'd hear me say that, but that's what it was kind of like. And, you know, and yeah, and I think everything that happened in that club was the real, it proved to me that America could do it. And it's a shame that it took more than 15 years later for it to really happen in America.
When Gareth came to me to put the whole idea together for the album and the concept, he mentioned, you know, working with these great artists, iconic artists, you know, that really fused the whole house and techno scene. You know, looking back at how these guys had put music together back in the day, they were using a lot of really old sequencing technology and old synths and old mixing consoles, old effects units. And what we wanted to try and do really was fuse a lot of the old technology with the new technology. Now, sort of what's new on the market at the moment is Ableton Live. That's a fantastic package that we felt that we could do the bulk of the production process. You started out the whole process, the writing process, really in Live, didn't you?
Yeah, the bulk of the actual album has been created on Live, and that's why, you know, it's a very cutting edge technology, and that's what we wanted to create and why we wanted to use that. And obviously we mixed the album on the Neve desk. And the idea was, we had so much, the album in its entirety has obviously a mixture of sounds, house and techno across the spectrum, and there's been input from different producers, so it was very important to gel that album in a particular way. And again, looking at it from an older piece of technology from back in the day, we used the actual Neve desk.
That really gave it its character, because we were really keen on doing as much of the production work inside the box as we could. And we also knew that we were going to be bringing this album out in a live concept. So what better than use Ableton Live for doing that? It gave us one platform to not only write the music, do some production, even though that we were mixing outside of the box, and then take everything back inside Ableton Live to get it ready for the live set. And at that point we were beginning to introduce some new technology based on old technology, which was the new Roland TR-8. We were using the TB-3. You know, these models are in the System 1 again. You know, we talked to Adam and he loves his System 100 synth. You know, so we're using sort of modern day versions of this gear, mixing it with the old analog consoles, old hardware effects units, hardware compressors, but also using software to try and get this culmination or morph of sound.
And I think as well, to utilise that desk in an electronic production as well, and using something like Ableton Live hadn't really been done before, or it certainly, tying in with what our concept was. But I think as well, it's very important. The album was never. It was gelling all this together to wasn't necessarily to create an actual old school sounding album. It was to gel all these different techniques and technologies together to create something that was unique, but obviously heralded back to that to where it originated from.
Exactly, and I think another thing that's really important about the journey that we decided to have with the old technology and the new technology is we wanted to get back into that zone where you were experiencing the frustrations of having to work like that. Because, you know, when you were working on an analog console with lots of hardware synths and sequencers, you had to commit the mix.
Yeah, and that's what we had to
do. And this is what we had to do. So we were feeling the pain, let's say, again. Yeah. Of having to make these very, very important decisions, because
there was no going back.
There wasn't any going back at all. So if we were to go back and now remix that album,
it would be ultimately a different sound.
Ultimately a different sound, because you know, every time that you're turning that equipment on and heating those transistors up, it's just, you know, it's just completely different.
I think I've done the album more for myself more than anything else. You know, if people pick up on the idea of what I've tried to achieve, you know, it's like success, brilliant. But I think for me, it's more an end game. I've always had this idea, this concept that I've wanted to fulfill. I think I've done that, and hopefully people will pick up on it. If they don't, you know, I'll be satisfied with what I've completed for me and for the label. The thing we've always tried to do, that again, it ties in with what we've always tried to do with the label. We've never really been susceptible to trends, etc. So we've always tried to work with a variety of different artists, from house and from techno, from, you know, the kind of older guy to the new guy. So I think it'll just complement what we've been doing as a label as well. So I'm not trying to educate people, no, but maybe if it is maybe, because I guess you're looking at different markets. If it is, you know, new fans or music lovers, whatever, that have picked up on it, then they might not have heard of some of it, or they might not have been aware of some of the scene. And I think, again, coming back to the concept of it being an original album, a remix, and obviously, you know, we're doing a documentary on it, so that people actually can understand what it's all about.